We're lucky to have Pat Schuber here tonight, who's going to talk about war in Italy and Sicily. And I will leave Dr. Schuber to his accolades. That's the briefest introduction.
Thank you. Maybe we just hit the light so this might show a little bit better. Well, good evening, everyone.
Hi.
Good evening.
And I'm delighted to be back. This is my second opportunity to be with the World War II Book Club, and I want to thank Rich and John for the kind invitation to be here with you again. Wish John a speedy recovery, and look forward to seeing him in the near future. You might remember I was here, I think it was about a year and a half ago, I spoke about Operation Anthropoid, the assassination of Reinhard Heydrich. He's still dead, don't worry about him. John and Rich had contacted me about coming back, and they had been on this tour, as well as several other people, I think, that I had done with Alp Tours from Oregon, Tony Cisneros. And I've done the war in Italy actually several times beyond this tour, as well as some other times, concentrating around Monte Cassino particularly. And I've actually done it with British military officers, which is kind of fascinating in itself. So what we're going to do tonight is take a look at the war in Italy. We're going to just cover one part of it for brevity purposes, or at least get it in before breakfast, which is the period from July 1943, the invasion of Sicily, all the way to the liberation of Rome. There's a whole other campaign, obviously, that takes place up until May 2nd, 1945, when the Germans finally surrender, which would be the subject of another lecture for the purpose of getting the important parts in tonight. So we're going to cover this period of time from June 43 to June 44. I should mention to you, by the way, as a way of background, that Rich asked me to do was that I'm a professor at Fairleigh Dickinson University. It's my 12th year there. I teach leadership and law. I'm a military historian in many ways, and I use the lessons of the wars for leadership lessons for our students, as well as for other groups that have asked me to do leadership staff rides, among other things, for them. And I just told Rich I'm going to Normandy on April 21st to take the state police chiefs, 20 of them, across the Operation Overlord. So that should be interesting. So here we want to take a look at the war in Italy from this time period. So I started with this piece of artwork, which you can still find around Rome. What I find interesting about Italy is, as opposed to going to Germany, is that in Germany, all the vestiges of Hitler and the Nazi Party are obviously been demolished, terminated, and destroyed in many cases. Which is okay, I'm fine with that. I mean, but there's some historical buildings, unfortunately, that have been destroyed as a result of that. But in Italy, the treatment of Mussolini is a little bit different. After the war, there was really no, there was opprobrium aimed at Mussolini and the Fascist Party. The fact of the matter is the vilification of Mussolini was short-lived. And to a great extent, much of what he might have done or left as a token of his memory is still there. And you can find it relatively easily. So this this kind of relief is up on the hills in Rome at what is called the Foro Italico. And it's the former government buildings that he was having built where he was going to move the fascist government headquarters to up on the hill. You can see these buildings, by the way, when you leave the airport. When you leave Leonardo da Vinci, you can look over and you can see these buildings up on the hill. So anyway, if you take a look at this, you can see how this very typical of that time period, the fascist regimes, the Nazi regimes, this glorification of what they've done. And here, this is Mussolini, obviously, as a result of victories in Ethiopia, among other things, that were important to him and to his regime. So that's the one thing I found in Italy, in Rome, that's very interesting. There is still a remnant of his party, by the way, that's in the parliament. And one of the leading lights of it is his granddaughter, who is still alive and very actively a part of this. So let's take a look at this and get this started. So with the So with the beginning of the war and the entrance of the United States into the war, there's a significant difference of opinion between ourselves and the British leadership, between Roosevelt and our military leadership led by General Marshall, and the British leadership led by Winston Churchill and British military leaders as to where the initial invasions of Axis territory should take place. And a series of conferences will be held to make those decisions. So beginning with the Arcadia Conference in December of 1941, right after Pearl Harbor, where Churchill comes immediately to the United States and stays in the White House, where the decision for Europe first is reached. Through these conferences from Casablanca in January of 43, in which this picture is taken. I love this picture, by the way. De Gaulle looks very, very uncomfortable, and that's General Girard over on the left. And the Trident Conference in May of 43, up to the Quadrant Conference in the summer of 43 in Quebec, the Trident Conference taking place in Washington, a series of decisions will be made by the Allied planners for the purpose which will create the Italian campaign, or what was known as the British strategy of the Mediterranean. All right? So Churchill's argument to Roosevelt is going to be that we are not yet ready to assault mainland Europe and take out the Germans, but rather we should do it by attacking some of their weaker points. And one of the weaker points, Churchill will argue, is going to be Italy. And he's going to call it the soft underbelly of the Axis. And he's going to argue to Roosevelt and his military advisors that Italy is ripe for the picking. That by this time of the war, in 1942 and early 43, that the regime in Rome, Mussolini's regime, is tottering and teetering. And it's not going to take much for it to collapse. And with that, the belief is that Italy would fall to the Allies and be an access up into the softer underportion of Germany. And he's going to argue that very vociferously. Now, one could argue, and many have, that this is part of Churchill's Mediterranean strategy of controlling the Mediterranean and its access to India and the East, among other things. But there's also an argument that Churchill, by the time the Italian campaign takes place, the Russians are starting to stabilize their front. And there's also a concern on Churchill's part, who has a kind of a big picture mentality, that the advent of the Russians, or the Red Army, into Eastern Europe would be somewhat a future disaster. And he's going to, I think that's in the back of his mind here also. So our position on this is very difficult. We're not as enamored to this strategy as Churchill is. And we've agreed to a Europe first strategy early on, and that's a subject of a whole lecture in and of itself, how they arrived at that. But the Americans under General Marshall are going to argue from the beginning that we should be planning the cross-channel invasion. And if you do, you know, we do an Overlord or D-Day lecture, we would put more time into that. But suffice it to say, from the earliest, we're arguing that maybe we should start looking at a foothold on the channel in 1942. And if not 42, by 43. And that any other strategy that takes us away from that is diverting precious resources, both in manpower and logistics, from what the initial focus should be of knocking the Germans out by a cross-channel invasion. The British are going to resist this very, very strongly. And they're going to come to the initial conferences better prepared than we are. And they're going to argue that you're not prepared yet for this type of an operation. And Churchill's first argument, as we know, is going to be North Africa. And he's going to convince Roosevelt. And Roosevelt's feeling is this. As we build up our military forces in this country, we had very little experience with regard to wartime activity. But he doesn't want to let the military kind of be fallow, waiting for the proper time for a cross-channel invasion. And he authorizes Operation Torch, which would be the invasion of North Africa. And at the successful conclusion of that, as that
operation went to its successful conclusion, although hard fought, the British and Americans are going to start to think about what's the next step. And Marshall is going to argue one more time at the Trident Conference, he's going to argue in May of 43 that it's now time to plan and put together the cross-channel invasion. And he's going to put his foot down on this. Churchill again will argue this: we're not ready for this, and that the Italy is ripe for the picking. They've been beaten in North Africa. Several hundred thousand of their soldiers have been captured. There's a belief of war weariness in Italy and disgruntlement with the Mussolini, and there was, and that it's now proper for him to be deposed and Italy be grabbed by the Allies and allow us to make, provide for an alternative way to get to Germany. So the agreement will be reached, much to the chagrin of Marshall. And I can only understand, I mean, I'm a great fan of Marshall's. Marshall must have fumed throughout all these meetings, as we know he did. And so the decision will be made that in the short term, and the Americans will insist this is going to be only short term, that we will start with the invasion of Sicily. We will move from North Africa to Sicily for the purpose of clearing the Mediterranean and giving us an option potentially to the mainland of Italy. The commander of that operation is going to be General Dwight D. Eisenhower. We all know Eisenhower's background, again, the West Pointer. Doesn't see combat in the First World War, a great planner, a favorite of Marshall's. And Marshall had made him the chief of his plans division, and he's the one who planned the initial operations for what would be Operation Roundup, the collecting of supplies in England for the cross-channel invasion. But instead, he's given command in the Operation Torch with a kind of a diffident result as a result of his command leadership at that time. But he learns. And he's given command of the operation to capture Sicily, which is going to be known as Operation Husky. But he's given a British sub-commander, or deputy commander, which is going to be, who at that time is not yet Field Marshal, but will be later on, General Harold Alexander. Now, Alexander is an interesting character. He had fought bravely in the First World War, been wounded, and had served very honorably and admirably. When the war starts, he's going to show, Second World War starts, he's going to see action in both theaters. He's going to be in Africa for a period of time. He's going to then be in Burma with responsibilities for trying to protect India from the Japanese coming through, with mixed results, although he does save India. And when this operation is being planned, he's already back in North Africa, being the Mediterranean commander for the British with Bernard Montgomery as the commander of the 8th Army on the field. So Alexander becomes deputy to Dwight Eisenhower for this operation. And after Eisenhower will eventually leave to take charge of the soon-to-be-approved cross-channel invasion known as D-Day, Alexander will succeed him basically as the commander of overall commander in the Mediterranean. And later on will receive the command of the honor of being a field marshal. Interesting thing here is I was telling Rich at lunch, at dinner here tonight, that when you take a look at the command structure that Eisenhower puts together for the Husky, it's almost a mirror image in many ways of the leaders he's going to choose to be a part of his leadership team for Overlord, except for Alexander. And there's a story behind that. He's going to have Admiral Cunningham is going to be part of his operation. He's going to have Air Marshal Tedder is going to be part of this operation. Bradley is going to be part of this operation. Eventually Montgomery is going to be part of this operation. It's almost a mirror image of the command structure that's going to take place in D-Day. So I've often argued as I've reviewed the Husky operation that it becomes a blueprint for Overlord in some ways, particularly on the lessons of what not to do. Now, an interesting story here is in a sidelight for this. When Eisenhower is sent to the England to take charge in January of 44, as in the height of the campaign in Italy, Bradley is going to argue with him that he should take Alexander with him, and that Alexander should go to be his sub-commander or his deputy commander, just like he was in the Mediterranean. And what they were trying to do was cut Montgomery out. And the idea of the argument is made in Bradley's memoirs that we might have prevented a lot of trouble later on if Alexander had been there and not Montgomery. Well, I'll leave that up to you to think about. It's not really the subject of this lecture, but it's an interesting one anyway. And so Operation Husky will be planned. And it will consist of two major landings with the British and let's see if this is working. There it goes. With the British landing in this area and the Americans landing here between Lakata and Yella, right here. We will land here with three divisions, the 1st, the 3rd, and the 45th initially. And the British will land with their forces in this area here. And the command of the operation for the Americans is given, this is the 7th Army now been created, is George Patton, who has come to success in the North African campaign, helping to bail Eisenhower out after the Kasserine Pass. And over here will be commanded by Bernard Montgomery. The idea is going to be we're going to land here, and the British will come up the coast, capturing these important ports to the purpose of grabbing Messina, which is obviously very close to the Italian mainland right in here. And Americans, and this is something Patton is not very happy about, will operate kind of like a guard on the flank, moving up beside them, helping them out along the way. And you know very well this is not going to sit well with Patton, quite frankly. And so, but the operation is going to be very important in a number of ways. First of all, it provides for an extensive amount of cooperation between the Army and the Navy and its allied tactical air, the RAF, and for our purposes, I think it's the 9th Air Force, the 9th Army Air. The commanders here, obviously, are Patton here and Montgomery over here. And it's going to be also, this is going to be the first time that the United States is going to utilize airborne troops. The 82nd Airborne, the oldest airborne unit in the American Army. Been initially a Army division in 1917, but in 1942 it has been converted to airborne and is commanded by Matthew Ridgway. And the idea here is going to be that the 82nd Airborne is going to come in advance and land in this particular area with the purpose of capturing an airfield that's going to be very vital to the Americans and the British at Ponto Olivo, right a little bit in this particular area here. So the operation gets underway on July the 9th. There is extreme deception here, another aspect of what we're going to see in D-Day. There's a deception operation here. You probably remember it from books that have been written recently, Operation Mincemeat. We leave a British officer, a body, dressed as a British officer, with a set of documents chained to his arm that indicate that the invasion, that's prospective, the Germans knew something was up, is going to take place in Greece. And the body washes up in Spain, of course, which is Franco, and gradually makes its way to the German Abwehr. And the Germans take it seriously. Hitler will take several divisions and move them over to Greece, which is one of the objectives, by the way, that Churchill's going to argue here, that the invasion of Italy, Sicily, and then later Italy, is going to siphon off major German forces away from any potential attack that might take place if the cross-channel invasion takes place. He's going to argue that strenuously. And to a certain extent, one can argue that they're going to do this. And Hitler will do this as a result. So we land on July the 9th with a bombardment, aerial and naval. And the Air Force, the airborne, will land. And this is going to be a very, very scattered operation. Some of the men don't make it. It's very, very windy. They land away from where they're supposed to be. And then several days later, when Pat orders a second landing, many of the planes are going to be shot down by our own forces, because of failure of communication between the Navy and the airborne forces. We'll lose a significant number of men in this. It's a very tragic lesson that we're going to learn about airborne operations here. And the Germans have two divisions here. The Hermann Göring division, a panzer division, which is very strong. And they have the 15th Panzer Grenadier division here. There are at least four Italian divisions here. And heavy fighting actually takes place here. The commander of the operation for Germany in the southern Mediterranean area is Albert Kesselring, who quickly sees that they're going to have to fight the Allied landing here to prevent Sicily from being taken, and he's been ordered by Hitler to do so. So the Germans are going to rush their troops, their tanks, into this particular area, and heavy fighting is going to take place all along this area. And particularly, it's going to hold the British up. And the British are going to be held up here for a significant period of time as the Americans attempt to break out from this area, which we are going to be able to do, particularly with the capture of the airfield here at Ponte Olivo. To make a long story short, before we go on to the other picture, we've got this map up, the British are going to fight their way up the coast here with very difficult operations. You may have heard of the Primusol Bridge operation, which is going to take place up in here. But in the meantime, Patton is going to break free, and he's going to head for Palermo, and he's going to capture Palermo, much to the chagrin of the British who want him over here, and he's going to proceed along here through Cefalù, all the way along here. There'll be several little amphibious landings along here, trying to get to Messina over here. In the meantime, the Germans have withdrawn, and they've created a defense position right in here, along Mount Etna, with its anchor at a small town in the mountains called Troina, and where most of the heavy fighting is going to be here as the Germans gather in this particular area and eventually are going to escape across the straits before they can be captured or closed down. So let's take a look at some of the operation. George Patton is its commander of the U.S. 7th Army, commanding the British Army. On the British 8th is General Montgomery. And I put up Admiral Ewing here because I like him. Admiral Ewitt is the commander of the American naval forces during this operation, as well as other Italian operations. He will also command the American naval forces on Operation Dragoon, the invasion of southern France in August of 44, after the D-Day landings. But I like him because he's from New Jersey. All right? He's from Hackensack. All right? As a naval graduate, saw action in the First World War. In fact, the history of him is interesting. He was actually on the Great White Fleet that Teddy Roosevelt had sent around the globe. And he'll be responsible here. Does a relatively good job here. So the invasion for us takes place in between Lakata and Gela. This is one of the significant beaches. In fact, you can see it over here. I'm sorry. You can see it over here in this picture, right in the back here. This is the landings here. The beach here that I took this picture on, very flat as you can see. There's only one little memorial here. It's up on the roadway here. That's all that would recognize this as a major part of the operation with regard to that. As our forces, the 1st and the 3rd Divisions have, and then later the 45th will push through here. Commanding, as we saw, was Albert Kesselring. Kesselring is a Luftwaffe commander. Fought valiantly in the First World War. Early on, it seemed the importance of air aviation had become, during the interwar years, involved in aviation. And his first commands are going to be with the Luftwaffe, commanding Luftwaffe forces in Poland and in Russia. Before his capabilities are seen in a greater area, and he is set to command all forces that the Germans have in the Mediterranean theater to aid the German Africa Corps, then heavily being challenged by the British and the Americans. After the war, Kesselring will command all the way through, almost to the end of the war, but not quite. He'll be moved over to the Western Front, the Western Theater, much towards the end of the war, when it's much too late. He'll be tried for war crimes, for some of the things we'll see before we finish here today. And he will be granted some reprieve because some of the American generals, including General Clark, Mark Clark will write a letter on his behalf, and he will be not pardoned so much, but released early. He's been then sentenced to death, to life imprisonment, to being left, and he dies in 1960. So some of the key points that are taken here, you might remember these, Rich. Punta Oliva, this ridgeline captured by the 82nd Airborne. The gentleman who owns this farmhouse in here has a small museum that he maintains with a lot of the relics of the battle, and there's a memorial here to the 82nd Airborne, particularly to the men killed here on the second landing. And you'll see along this ridgeline that leads towards the airport, these wartime pillboxes. And you can see how much the fighting was in this area by taking a look at the bullet holes all over this area. The 82nd will capture this in aid of other elements of the American forces that capture the airport, which is going to be important for the control of the city, control of the island itself. The main fighting takes place for us here at Troyena. This is a mountain. It's high in the mount. It's high in Mount Etna, along the volcanic mountain in the northeastern corner of Sicily, and it's heavily it's the linchpin of the German Etna line, in which they are holding off both the American and British forces from capturing Messina. And we're going to have to take this as the British move up on the right-hand side. And you're looking from the vantage point of the Americans as they attempted to advance on this city at the tail end of the battle at the beginning of August 1943. This was heavily defended by the Germans. And one of the things about the Italian campaign that reminds me a lot of the First World War is the Germans always had the high ground. They always had the high ground. And we had to attack through this lowland up in this thing, and it's going to take us a while to do this. But eventually it's going to be captured. And some of the bloodiest fighting is going to take place along this line here. So, what's going to happen then beyond that is the capture eventually of Messina. But by the time we capture Messina on August the 13th, 1943, the Germans are gone. Kesselring has gotten permission to withdraw his troops, and over a several period of time, while his defense positions hold off the Allied troops, he will bring all of his men, as well as all of his equipment, across the Straits of Messina onto the mainland of Italy, where it will become the linchpin of the German defenses that we will face as we slog it up the Italian boot. But the Allied victory in Sicily has had important consequences, particularly for Churchill. It's validated his arguments to a great extent, but it's drawn us deeper into his Mediterranean strategy, as we're not yet ready for a cross-channel invasion. And so what Churchill immediately does upon what looks like the successful conclusion of this campaign is going to be to argue that the campaign should continue. We've had victory. And now let's grab Italy. And he's going to argue for an invasion of the mainland, the continuation of that soft underbelly. In the meantime, during the campaign in Sicily, Mussolini has been deposed. On July the 25th, 1943, the Fascist Grand Council, meeting in the Palazzo Veneto in Rome, has held an emergency meeting. And it's voted what would be the equivalent of a vote of no confidence in El Duce. Make matters worse and to rub salt into the wound, his son-in-law, married to his daughter, is going to be one of the people moving the motion. And Mussolini will go to visit the king, Victor Emmanuel III, who up until this time has been a ready partner of Mussolini's, but recently he's gotten a backbone. And at the presidential palace, Mussolini will plead with the king to help him restore his power. But instead, the king has him arrested. And as a result, he's pushed in what I think is an ambulance. And he's pushed out, and he's brought to several places where he's incarcerated, eventually landing up on the top of a somewhat remote mountain north of Rome called the Grand Sasso. All right? In the meantime, his position is taken over by his former chief military officer, Marshal Pietro Badoglio. Badoglio had been fired for his failure to bring victory in North Africa and was a very, very bitter man. When Mussolini is deposed, he's going to be able to, the king is going to turn to him. In fact, they've been plotting this all along, to take over the government and secretly open negotiations with the Allies, what Churchill is looking for. But the Germans are not stupid. They are aware something's going on, and they'll have some discussions with him. And on the surface, Badoglio and the king will offer their support of the Axis cause. But in the meantime, the Germans are going to make plans for the potential takeover of the Italian mainland as a result of this. And plotting goes back and forth. General Ridgway, actually, they're going to come into Rome secretly, and they're going to do some negotiating here with regard to this. And there's going to be some promises made. But the Italians drag their feet on this. And the Americans are planning a new invasion for the mainland, which is going to take place in early September, 43. And so Badoglio's government is going to be pushed to surrender for the purpose of allowing the Allies in. In fact, we offered to drop the 82nd on Rome. Now, people have argued that would have made all the 82nd prisoners of war. But the reality is that the Italians had, and the Italian fighting units are often denigrated, but there were several really good ones, including several armored divisions, which were actually around Rome at that particular time, which might have aided this. Now, whether it would have worked, who knows? Suffice to say, it doesn't happen because Badoglio's government flees. They surrender on the 8th of September, officially announce they're switching sides, and then the king and Badoglio flee Rome. The Germans come down immediately, taking Rome under their command, beginning what's going to be a very harsh period of occupation for them. A very little studied part of the German operation here. Italian soldiers are murdered for not surrendering. Some of them are sent to concentration camps as a result of this. And fighting takes place between Italian units and German units during this occupation. If you go to the Gross Rosen concentration camp, there is a memorial to 25 Italian soldiers who had been taken during this period of occupation, sent to Gross Rosen, which was none of the camps were great. This was a heavy work camp attached to a rock quarry. And when they arrived, they were immediately sent to work in the quarries, and they refused to go. They said to the camp commandant, "We were your allies. You can't treat us like this." And the camp commandant had them shot. And so there's a memorial to them in the Gross Rosen. But it's a classic example. If you've seen the movie, Captain Corvelli's Mandolin, this is a movie that depicts this event that takes place here. So the Allies now have decided on a three-pronged assault. British forces are going to land from the Straits of Messina, are going to land on the toe of Italy in two locations. U.S. forces are going to come up the coast, the west coast, and they're going to come up at a place called Salerno. Originally, the idea was to capture Naples. We need the port, but our air coverage doesn't go as far as Naples, but it will cover Salerno. So Salerno and Naples are approximately 40 to 50 miles apart. They're not that far apart. So the idea was we'll land on the beaches of Salerno, move up, capture Naples, and that will be our port for the operations on Rome, which is the ultimate goal here. And the commander now of what is now the 5th Army, not the 7th Army, is General Mark Clark. Now, Mark Clark is a West Pointer. He is from upstate New York. He has been wounded and cited for bravery during the First World War. And he has served in a series of advisory and staff positions during the interwar period. And he's come to the attention of two important people. It's always important to have good people who like you at high places. One is George Marshall, and the other is Dwight D. Eisenhower. Not bad combination here. I mean, the third could have been FDR, but he wasn't involved here, right? And Clark will advance up the line, becoming a deputy to Eisenhower during the Mediterranean campaign in its early stages. Now, you might ask, although I know because you're a part of the World War II book club, you already know this answer, why isn't George Patton commanding this operation? After all, he was the victor on Sicily. Well, he's in the doghouse by this time.
Yeah.
Because it's in the Sicily campaign that the slapping incidents take place. Along the coast, the northern coast, there are two of them, separated by approximately 10 days. And Patton, to his credit, used to visit the troops in their hospitals. Good thing. And he would try to buck them up. And you know the story, you've seen the movie, you've seen what George C. Scott does. He runs into two soldiers who don't seem to have any wounds. He's told that they are suffering from battle fatigue, among other things. We didn't know, you know, there was not a great appreciation for what we know today as PTSD. And as a result of which, he slaps both men at different times. They kind of cover up the first incident. They have trouble covering up the second incident. The doctor complains about it. But Eisenhower reprimands him, and they shut it down. Only to find out that Drew Pearson in the United States finds out about it and puts it in a column, and all hell breaks out politically in the United States. Eisenhower is given permission to either fire Patton or do something else with him. So he puts him in the doghouse. He gives him command of Sicily, which is valueless. There's no more combat there. And he has a great little office in the palace in Palermo, but he really controls nothing. And so he will last in that doghouse, as we know, all the way up until shortly thereafter the D-Day invasion, where he commands the Fortitude operation, the deception operation, and we know the history of that. So anyway, Mark Clark now has succeeded him, and Mark Clark will command the operation. His tactical commander will be General Ernest Dawley, will command the actual men on the ground. And they will land in the area of Salerno. So the Salerno operation is known Operation Avalanche. The British have landed already. And the idea is they're going to come up on the eastern side, cross over. As we come on up the coast, we're going to join together, move on up, and Rome will be ours for the picking. After all, Mussolini is gone. And we'll land on a series of bases in the Salerno Gulf of Salerno here. Today it's a modern set of beaches, very similar to the D-Day beaches, which are used by the public for bathing, et cetera, and the city of Salerno itself. And we'll land here under General Dawley, among others here, with the British 10th Division with us under General McCreary. Mark Clark again here, General George Patton. And here's one of the major landing sites. Right here, just outside the city of Salerno. The mountains on the far right there really bracket the landing beaches today. When I took this picture in July back around 2013, you could see people were actually on the beach. There is no monument on the beach, but there are several monuments further along, as we're going to see here, particularly these. This one is to the Texas 36th Division, which we'll come across shortly. This was a National Guard unit made up mostly of Texans that will have a very tragic outcome during the Monte Cassino campaign. This water tower here served as a German machine gun bunker, and the elements of the 36th Division took this out before they could move on from the beachhead. This is featured in a number of different memoirs. This water tower here is featured in a number of memoirs from different soldiers who came across this over the course of time. It held them up for a period of time as the Germans had heavily fortified it. For those of you who like Greek and Roman culture, some of the finest Greek ruins are located here, south of Naples, in Paestum. And this was heavily defended by the Germans, too, in this whole area. As we move up from Salerno, trying to move our way up, we're going to come through these Greek ruins, as you can see on this picture over here, of elements of the American troops moving along the same stone road here in front of the Greek temple. I think this is the one for the sun here, right here. So this was going to be a major area fought over during the course of that time. And what's going to happen here has been really the signature of all of this, is the Germans, as they pulled out from the southern boot of Italy to get out of the way of Montgomery, are gonna come in and take these mountain areas that surround the Salerno Basin. And they're gonna control all of those heights with heavy artillery and will hold up our invasion force in Salerno for a considerable period of time, with heavy fighting taking place in this area with strenuous casualties. General Dawley will be fired by Mark Clark for his failure to get into the interior from here, as we're held up here for almost 6 to 8 weeks, taking heavy casualties. Again, I don't really have a good picture of the mountain areas here, but if you've ever been here and you've looked around, you know the whole area is ringed by mountains, and the Germans are on top of all of them. And so there are these iconic places that all battlefields have that are going to be heavily fought over. This is the tobacco factory, a semicircular set of buildings that were relatively heavily built that are going to be fought over by the Americans and the Germans. They're going to change hands several times. It's one of the areas with hand-to-hand fighting. This is the remnants of it today, which is somewhat of a memorial, although there's very little signage here. But what the Germans are going to do is make one attempt to push us off the beaches. They're going to make one big attempt with reinforced armored divisions that are going to be brought down from Rome. And they're going to make a move on the beaches with the attempt to push us off. And they almost do it. They get as far as this bridge, which is known today as the Burke Bridge. As they're coming down, we're looking at the way they are. We're looking from where they're coming. See the mountains in the back? And the Germans are going to be coming down this road. And the Allied forces are going to be across this area here. The bridge is going to be down over here. And they're going to fight a huge battle in this area that's going to hold the Germans up with the aid of our TAC air and our naval forces in the Gulf that are going to hold the Germans up. And the Germans, as a result of this, are going to start to withdraw to the north. Coming up on the right-hand side, or on the eastern side, is finally Montgomery. Now, I love reading British accounts of this. They often argue that Montgomery was speedily operating on the eastern coast when he's not. He's coming up very, very slowly. And this is going to be a major argument of American commanders throughout the war. However, October 1st, Naples falls. And as you can see, these young boys here are going to be part of a kind of a guerrilla operation that kind of sooms up out of the city itself while the Germans are still here. The Germans will enact terrible retribution in the city, leaving a number of explosives, murdering civilians as they withdraw from this. This is all of the indictments that are going to be handed out on Kesselring when the war ends here. And you can see how young these men are at this particular time. But this port is extremely important to us. Now, in the meantime, you might be asking yourself, and I know I can see it on your eyes, you're in your mind, whatever happens to Mussolini,
yeah,
right? I mean, now when we left Benito, he had been deposed by the king, by the fascist council. He had gone pleading to the king to be reinstated, and the king had had him arrested. It was like a drama. I guess the policemen were hiding in the bushes when he showed up, and they jumped out and grabbed him, you know? So they've moved him around. In initial stages, the Germans are asking where he is, and the Italians are not telling them. And Germans are going to be looking for him, trying to figure out, because Hitler wants him saved. He's his Axis partner, after all. And so the real people who are going to find Mussolini are going to be the Gestapo, under Herbert Kappler, an SS officer. His intelligence network is going to finally track Mussolini down to a high vantage point on a high mountain that's a ski resort known as the Grand Sasso. And they pretty much validate with some Italian officers that he's there and guarded well. So they put together a rescue operation, which is one of the more dramatic actions of the war in many ways. Under the command of this man here, you probably remember from the Bulge, Lieutenant Colonel Otto Scorzetti, an SS officer whose specialty was commando operations. And he'll be the one who'll command the English-speaking German soldiers during the Bulge, if you remember that. Scorzetti will come to real prominence here. He's given command of this operation to bring in light planes and gliders, hopefully, onto the top of the mountain with the idea of overwhelming the garrison and rescuing Mussolini. Now, the real hero here is going to be a German army officer by the name of General Vanderheide. And it's going to be him who's going to actually do the work here. Skorzeny will come along for the ride. And they will land on the top of this mountain on September the 12th, 1943. And there will be no fighting. The Italians throw down their weapons. They don't defend. And Skorzeny evidently jumps out of his glider, runs across the field, this field, and he jumps into the hotel, this hotel, through this door right here. And he jumps past the people at the desk, and he asks, where is Del Duce? And they tell him he's on the third floor, I think. He runs up the stairs, he draws the door bursts open, he says, the Fuhrer has sent me to, and this is dramatic, isn't it, folks? The Fuhrer has sent me to save you. And as a result of that, the El Duce, who wanted to be saved, but not necessarily in this way, is brought out in this way, all right? And he's stuffed into this plane, this Fiesler's torch, that includes not only Skorzeny and Mussolini, but a third man, the pilot, in this little plane, and they take off from this ice field right here. And then, according to eyewitnesses, the plane disappears over the side of a cliff. And that might have been the end of the story, folks, except it grabbed its wind and took off, heading him to a military base, then on to Rome, then on to Rastenburg, where the Fuhrer will greet him at the rail station in Rastenburg. For Mussolini, a period of enforced support is going to take place. He will be responsible for the creation of, he will be responsible through the Germans for the creation of what's called the Salo Republic, from a little village in the north of Italy, where he will establish his new government. And with other troops that are still loyal to him, will be with his German minders watching him at all times and bugging his telephone, he will administer what's left of his rump government from that particular position. Something it is clear that he did not really want to do. So here's another picture. There's the location where he comes out. This is still used as a ski resort, folks. And as Rich and I both know, because we've both been up here, in May this could be heavily snowed in. I had a lucky day. We were able to get up, but the 2 days before, there had been a blizzard up here. This is his bedroom. It's maintained by the hotel in the way he left it. And as a result of that, Mussolini will go back into Axis control, controlling his little rump northern portion of Italy. From there, however, he will adhere to the German racial policies with regard to the Jews. And it's during this period of time that many of the Jews from Italy who had been protected to a certain extent up until that time will be rounded up by the Germans, particularly in Rome, and then sent on to Auschwitz. Switching back to the main operation now. The Germans have retreated north, and they have bought valuable time to create a series of defensive positions to impede the Allied advance. And their biggest ones are a series of lines that are going to be known as the Winter Line, that are a series of defensive positions that are taking advantage of the river network and the mountain network at the narrowest part of Italy. As you know from Italy's geography and topography, there's a mountain range that comes down the spine, the Apennines, right? Coming down the spine. And at one of the apexes of that, in that narrow area, there's a Benedictine monastery known as Monte Cassino that goes back to the 6th century, founded by Saint Benedict. And that will be the linchpin of these defenses. To get there, the Allies moving on both sides of the mountains now, with Montgomery on the eastern sector, Clark on the western sector, are going to slowly push the Germans back as the Germans dig in this area. They'll cross the Volturno River and come up this valley. German guns, will be up on this mountain ridge here as the Americans come up through the valley. Now, this picture doesn't really do justice to this, but down in this tree line, there's a road that goes up the valley towards Monte Cassino, which is over here. And this was heavily defended and fought over. In fact, right over here, there's a huge monument to loyal Italian soldiers who had joined the Allied cause and were killed here. As the Americans and Italians now move up this road network, heading towards this area where the Rapido River is going to be, with the purpose of knocking the Germans out and moving towards Rome. On both sides of the Apennine, there are three roads that lead to Rome, eventually. On the eastern side is the number five, road five, which the British are going to advance up and be stopped. The Americans are going to try to come up roads number six, which is on the coast, and they get stopped because the Germans have flooded the areas, known as the Pontine Marshes, from Julius Caesar's time. And the only road available to them to advance is road number six, which is this one coming up this valley. So the American effort is now channeled in between these mountains, moving up towards the final area of the linchpin, back in here, Monte Cassino, which we'll see. So I think you get a kind of an understanding of why this was such a difficult campaign. Besides that, the area, troops are being husbanded for the cross-channel invasion, and so reinforcements are slow here. I counted from the records 18 countries' divisions in the Italian campaign, stretching from Brazil to Morocco, had divisions in all of the aspects of this part of the Italian campaign. It's the only thing that kept us in the ballpark here. All right? And so you have these monuments now here, for those of you who come up in this particular area. And we finally come up against, we break out of the valley, and there's a village sitting on the side of a mountain controlled by the Germans that's controlling the road network, San Pietro in Fine. And the 36th Division and the 34th Division are going to be sent up the hill, up the mountain, to try to capture this town. This is what the town looked like at the end of the battle, and this is what it looks like today. The town was fought over heavily.
Somebody help me with it. Who's the famous movie producer who comes here and does this?
Houston.
John?
Wasn't it Houston?
John Houston comes here and films this attack.
He's traveling along with the American troops when he films this attack. This film will be shown back here in the States. And the village is pretty much destroyed as we fight to finally capture it and allow us to move on. Again, here's another example. There, underneath it was a series of tunnels where the citizens would hide out during the battle and save themselves from the incessant bombing. This is a picture of the church and the way it looks like today. You see this mountain ridge behind it? That's where the Germans were. And they could fire down into the village itself. It's actually a pristine site. The new village is further down the hill, down the mountain. This village has been left as a war memorial, is quite a sight to see as you move across the valley. So as the Americans move forward, we've captured Foggia, which has now become an air force base, an air base for us and for the British. But we see the terrain and the weather have made it very difficult for the troops to move forward. And we've moved up to the winter line, the gist of it known as the Gustav Line, which is 100 miles south of Rome, controlling the Liri Valley and Highway 6 that goes up to Rome, with heavy artillery in all of the different mountain areas. And there are observers at the top of those mountains. And so by 1944, the beginning of 1944, the front has stabilized right in front of Monte Cassino. We can't move forward. We don't have enough troops to do so. And we're trapped on both sides of the Apennine Mountain. And again, troops are being siphoned off to the cross-channel invasion. And at Tehran, in November of 43 and December of 43, we confirm for Stalin that very fact that he's been pushing for, the second front is going to be confirmed. But we're also going to confirm that we'll attempt here, one last attempt is going to be made
to try to break the stalemate in Italy, and that will result in the Anzio invasion, which will take place in January of 44. The person pushing for that is Churchill. The American forces, by now Eisenhower, Bradley, and key American commanders have now moved to England in preparation for Overlord. The British are left in control of the operations under Harold Alexander, who now assumes command of the entire operation. Churchill pushes for the Anzio operation. Stalemate and come around them. Use our amphibious forces. Cross behind them, cut them off, and capture Rome. And he's going to push for this. It's a poorly planned operation, unfortunately. That is, basically, the attempt is going to be to force the Germans off this set of ridges that are controlled by the casino at monastery at Monte Cassino. There's what it looks like today. This is what happens during the battle, as you well know. The Germans will evidently never occupy the monastery. And the evidence would indicate that they did not. But that they were here on its footsteps with their observers. From this area, if you're in the area, you can see this for miles. They controlled the whole valley. And they could bring the artillery down on the American and British and French forces. And that's exactly what they're going to do. We will attempt to take this under three attacks from January through April of 44, attacking it from different areas, failing miserably to do so with high casualties. In February, the frustration is so great that based on evidence from the front line, the commanders, including Alexander, are going to be convinced that the Germans are using the Abbey for the purpose of that they are occupying it. And that if we can blow them out of there, we can take the whole place. And they will convince the Allied leaders to do this. And so on February, take a look at some of these photos. Here you get a great example of how the Monte Cassino actually controlled the area. There it is right there. German artillery is up in here. This is the lowland around the Rapido River that the 36th Division is going to cross over in its famous attack over the river in January in aid of the Anzio invasion. But look how it dominates the flat area here. This is Snake's Head Ridge. This is a ridge line coming up from over here that was attempted by the Americans, the Indians, and the New Zealanders to attempt to get around here to the Monte Cassino. I walked that ridge. It's tough and actually pretty precarious with a British officer. And these are the remnants of the tanks that were left there as the Germans blew them up as they came by. So here you get an idea of how hard this was. So on January the 20th, with Churchill's approval on a poorly planned invasion at Anzio, that's going to take place in January of 44, mid part of the year. The idea is to get behind the German forces, force them off these mountains, and capture Rome, and break the stalemate. To do that, however, the other allies along the line are urged to attack forward. Clark will order the 36th Division, commanded by Frederick Walker, remember this, a Texas National Guard Division, to advance across this river to take this area here to help relieve the pressure or fix the Germans in place while the Anzio invasion takes place. This operation is poorly planned. General Walker will argue with his bosses, Clark and General Keyes, who is the sub-commander, that this is a suicide mission, that the Germans are already heavily entrenched in here. His men are not prepared for this. They haven't trained for this. And this area has not been successfully reconned. And he's right. And that's exactly what happens. On the night of the 20th, 1944, under the cover of darkness, engineers will try to lead channels down to this body of water, which is moving very swiftly. The men will try to get across. They'll get across in some places, but not everywhere. And the Germans are alerted to the fact that they're there. And they control the high ground. In fact, if you took a look at the whole area, you'd see a whole ridge line that went this way. And these men are cut to pieces. 2,100 casualties. After the war, and they have to retreat across the Rapido. After the war, Texas politicians, legislators, senators will urge a congressional investigation of this operation with the idea of pinning responsibility on Mark Clark. A congressional hearing will be held in 1946, and Clark has to testify. But he will be found, he will be absolved, but it will leave a black mark on his career. These are some of the memorials to the Rapido Crossing. This is the area where it took place. This is the German's position. That little low area here is the Rapido River, also known as the Gary River at this location, the Garigliano River. This is the 30 monument to the 36th Division that's in the village of Sant'Angelo, which is to the west of the, was actually the middle of the operation itself. Allied commanders have started to change. New Zealand commander has taken greater charge in the Western theater, Lieutenant Bernard Freiberg. He's the one who's going to order the bombing of the Abbey. And the French now have a commander here, General Alphonse June, a former Vichy general who's changed sides and is now working with the Americans. And in his operation, he's got Moroccan troops who are going to be some of the most vicious fighters in the mountains. The landing at Anzio takes place on the 22nd of January, 1944, Operation Shingle, commanded by Major General John Lucas, a West Pointer with a relatively decent record in the First World War, among other things. And he will be, he will argue with Clark that he does not have enough men for this operation and that it's poorly planned. As a result of that, this operation is actually a surprise to the Germans. The Germans actually are fixed thinking about the operations that are actually taking place in front of Monte Cassino, and Kesselring is caught by surprise by this operation. However, Lucas does not take advantage. This is very controversial, by the way. Some will argue both sides of this. Lucas consolidates his position instead of advancing off the beaches, giving the Germans a chance to recoup and reconnoiter and bring reinforcements down from Rome, which they do. Once again, you know the story, they control the high ground. And Anzio will be hell's half acre in many ways. Heavy artillery will come down on the Anzio beachhead. Ships will be sunk in the harbor. The road to Rome is not open. The stalemate continues. Thousands of casualties are suffered. There's a revolt. There's an actual revolt and mutiny of British soldiers here that the British are going to suppress as a result of this. You have to go look for the records on this one. As our men get cut to pieces here, Clark will relieve Lucas and replace him again, taking a look at the Anzio landings here. This is the city of Anzio. These are the monument to the troops at the location of that. By the way, it's at the location of where this LST is. And fighting will create its own key places. Cisterna, a city to the south of the Anzio landings, will be fought over heavily during the course of the battle, back and forth. Isola Bella will be the furthest eastern, furthest southern portion of the Anzio beachhead. This farmer owns this property on which the Germans had a defensive position in this tree line. As elements of the 82nd Airborne are going to try to come up a canal that's over here and be cut to pieces right in this area, you can see the heavy fighting. This is at the roadway leading to this gentleman's farm. You can see the fighting here. This is now a housing development behind it. This is an original lintel that entered the houses back in those days. The flyover is another key area. Again, this is fought over heavily. That's the wartime picture of it. This is the modern iteration of it. There's a train station in here, Camp Helion, which is going to be heavily fought over during the course of the time. The Germans will almost push us off the beaches here as we sustain heavy casualties in this area, trying to break out and try to relieve the issue and capture Rome. Change in command takes place. Lucian Truscott will take command. Commander of the 45th Division will take command over General Lucas. Lucas will be with Clark for about a month before he's sent back to America to be a training general. He never sees combat again. In the meantime, the Germans in Rome are starting to feel the heat of various guerrilla operations. On March the 23rd, 1944, coming up this road, known as the Via Rosella, marching as they normally did singing to a police barracks right over here, is an SS police battalion. of approximately 100 soldiers marching in this direction to this barracks. Right here, where these bikes are, a man had planted in a garbage container a what we would know as an IED today. And members of the Italian resistance in Rome are going to be hiding along the area as these men come marching down. The bomb goes off, killing several of the soldiers, and fighting takes place in this area. You can still see the bullet holes on the original buildings right here. 33 German soldiers, SS, 33 SS Germans, 33 SS members are killed here. The Germans go berserk. Commanding out of the Gestapo headquarters, located here, and this is now a museum, they start rounding people up willy-nilly. They round up residents on the street. They round up people from their prisons, who they've got in anyway, and they bring them here. Hitler orders 10 Italians to be executed for every one of the German soldiers killed in that attack, of which there are 33. That's 3,330 people. And Herbert Kappler, the man on the left, is the SS Gestapo commander in Rome, aided by this man here, Erich Priebke, SS captain. They will round these men up and bring them to that Gestapo headquarters. And they will ride them out to this location, Ardiatine, a hill and cave structure on the outskirts of Rome. And they will bring them here in trucks. They've got 335 Italians in there. They find they've got five more than Hitler ordered. They decide to shoot them too. And they bring them into this entranceway here, and they're shot in groups of five until they're all dead. This is the monument that's located here. These are the monuments to the men. It's a very moving sight if you've ever gotten a chance to go here. This, in fact, is what it looks like. There's the memorial where they were killed. These are their bodies that were brought out later on and are arrayed in rows in a special memorial on the outskirts. Kappler will be tried for war crimes after the war and will be sentenced to life imprisonment after a long, drawn-out affair. And he'll die, basically, of cancer in the 1970s. Priebke will escape to Argentina and will be brought back to Italy in the 1990s as an 84-year-old man suffering from cancer. He'll be tried by the Italians and acquitted. The Germans will pick him up and try him. He'll die during the course of those particular proceedings. But on February the 15th, we bombed Monte Cassino, and it looks like this. Today it's been rebuilt like this. We only find out that the Germans weren't in there, and in fact, now they are, and this becomes a fortress. For which makes the difficulty of capturing it even that more difficult. On May the 17th, Polish soldiers coming up on the side end of the mountain, finally on the fourth attack over almost 5 months, finally break through to capture Monte Cassino. This is the most poignant Polish memorial on the side of the mountain that looks over towards Monte Cassino. This Pope John Paul II, when he made a visit to that particular place. And breakout takes place at the same time. By now the Germans are being worn down. The breakout, Monte Cassino was fallen, they start to withdraw. We break out of the Anzio bridgehead, and we make we head up towards, we head to cut the Germans off. And this becomes where it becomes very, very, very controversial. Mark Clark is given orders to cut the Germans off. The 10th Division, which is the bulk of the German troops, retreating from Monte Cassino area, the Gustav Line. The Germans are trying to create a new line north of Rome called the Gothic Line, which they will do. But Mark Clark disobeys orders, and he sends his troops up to Rome to capture it. Many people argue he was doing it for the purpose of saying, I captured Rome. The 10th German Division escapes. It could have been caught. And they will become the bulk of the defenders who will keep the rest of Italy German until the very, very end of the war. Rome falls on the 4th. There's some very, there'll be self-aggrandizing pictures of Mark Clark marching down to the center of Rome. If you've been to the center of Rome, you know exactly where he is. Rome will fall on the 4th, but look what the date is. 2 days later is D-Day, and this is almost an afterthought by this time. So he doesn't gain the actual thing. And he gains a large amount of opprobrium as a result of this. So what about Mussolini, who's been somewhat of a story all the way across? Well, This is the Via Torlonia. This was his official residence in Rome. It's been restored, both his residence, and it's an art gallery. Here's the same, there, this area right here, this is when his daughter Edda was married to his foreign minister, Count Ciano, here. That's Mussolini in black tails here. So we know that he orders the death of Ciano, and at the request of the Germans. So his son-in-law is murdered, is shot and killed. And Mussolini, we know, is captured by, as he tries to escape with the Germans, is captured by Italian partisans. He'll be held for a day or two. He's taken to this location where he will be taken out of a car and shot. And then we know what happens to him thereafter as he's strung up in the Via Loreto in Milan. A famous participant, Ernie Pyle, is here, a famous war correspondent who will die later in the Pacific. Audie Murphy gains much of his, not all of it, but his early attention to his bravery in Italy. Bill Malden, Willie and Joe will be in the Italian campaign. Daniel Inouye, later a Hawaii U.S. senator, and Bob Dole, who Inouye has passed away in the last couple of years. Bob Dole is still alive. The 10th Mountain Division, the 442nd Nisi Division, will gain their greater fame in the campaign after Rome. General Theodore Roosevelt will be in the Sicily campaign in the early stage before he moves over to the Overlord. William O. Darby will command the 1st Ranger Battalion. He will develop it as a result of his liking for the British doing the same thing. He will be involved in most every part of the campaign in Italy. He will die tragically near the end of the war when an 88 shell blows up in the middle of his staff meeting. And he will die before the war ends. So what about this whole campaign? What do we learn from it? Well, it had important implications. It held down 20 German divisions. By Sicily, the Germans were pulling out divisions from Russia. The Kursk operation, which had already been underway, is stopped by Hitler to take divisions out to move them towards the Balkans and to Italy. However, the Allied progress, as we saw, was slow and costly and destructive. Weather, topography, the failure, the fact that we were siphoning off everybody to go to the cross channel, so the operation here was not being fed the proper amount of reinforcements. It's somewhat of a secondary theater, but that doesn't take away from the bravery of the men who fought it under very difficult circumstances. And the detractors are going to argue that the Italian operations delayed the cross-channel invasion. I don't believe there could have been a successful invasion in 43, so I don't support the detractors in this. The British are going to argue the German submarines in the channel posed a major threat in 43. That's possible, but I don't believe that's the case. But we do have the fact that sufficient landing craft, although they were available in the Pacific, and German defense in northern was stronger in 44 than 43, one might argue that that's true. But the fact of the matter is, I think the Allied invasion of Italy did siphon off a tremendous amount of German strength. However, there is a cost to this. These are the 8,000 American dead who were killed in the Italian campaign very poignantly and properly. In all of our war cemeteries, particularly this one at Nettuno, which commemorates all of the American soldiers killed in the Italian campaign. There are 8,000 bodies that are buried here. And that's the end. Wow. Thank you, everybody. We ran a few more all this presentation, ran a little bit longer, but I'll take some questions. I'll be glad to answer some questions. Rich.
Yeah, real fast, you keep saying the soft underbelly, but even if you made it all the way up to the north of Italy, you got Switzerland in front
sure.
of
you. Sure, you had a mountain range, but they were hoping to grab the Brenner Pass, which I doubt they would have. However, the fact of the matter, among others, but the point was, I think the point was that they weren't, Churchill's mind is a little bit different than that. I think Churchill's arguing that, but I think Churchill sees an opportunity to move across the Adriatic and look at portions of what would be Trieste today, and the Balkans, trying to hold off the Red Army is what I think he's trying to do. That would have been something we would have adopted, quite frankly. Yes?
Could you talk a little bit more about how the Polish and the Indian troops, all those different troops, coordinated? What did they accept?
Well, first of all, they had their own commanders, number one. But they fought under either a British or American general, a commander. Or in the case of the French and the Moroccans, for example, a General June.
By the way, some of the most vicious fighting was done by June. And June had actually found a back door to mount a casino with his French Moroccan troops, where he beat an opening, calling for reinforcements from Mark Clark. There are several cases here, without going into belaboring this, where the opportunity to break this thing open could have happened if more troops were available or generals had understood the opportunity that they had. And June gives them one of those up in those mountains to the east of Monte Cassino. If many historians will argue, if everybody had followed his advice, they would have come around on Monte Cassino and ended this struggle 2 months before. But each of them had their own commander. So the Polish had General Anders. The Indians had their own commanders. Language could be a problem.
And did they work together?
Yes, they did. For the most part, they did. However, we do know the Moroccans were very feared, because often they didn't take prisoners, among other things, and there were some issues with regard to mutilations. And the Germans did not want to be captured by the Moroccans. Yeah, there are parts of the memoirs where you see there are language issues. Germans are having the same issue, by the way, with some of the amalgam of their troops. But they allowed them to have their own commanders, like Freiburg with the New Zealanders. The Indians had their own commanders, but the overall command was still allied. The coordination here is relatively decent for the most part. Yes, Richard?
I just want to make a comment. You showed the American cemetery.
Yeah.
When you go to Europe and you see these cemeteries, they're beautifully manicured, they're beautiful, you know, tombstones and what have you. The Italians have nice sayings cut on. And when you visit the German cemetery, you're greeted by this sign, and the thing's all weedy, and there's three bodies per site.
Per site.
And you're greeted by the sign, warning, poisonous snakes. So you don't even want to go there. Okay. It's just, what a contrast.
Recently, German students have been volunteering to go into these cemeteries and clean them up. And of course, there's a big difference. The German cemeteries, these stones are normally black.
Yes.
Low to the ground, whereas the typical American cemetery looks like the one you just saw here. And if you've been to Normandy, you've seen the one up on top of Colville's. I'm sorry. I'll come back.
One last comment. I don't know if anybody sees NPR, but I'm a dentist by profession, and there's some horrible press there. So I'd just like to point out, General Freeberg was a dentist.
I didn't know that.
In New Zealand.
He's actually born in England, but he's a New Zealander, because he grows up in New Zealand, you're right. Yes, sir.
You mentioned a number of times that there was a lot of angst about getting the invasion into France,
right,
into 43 and that, but it seemed to me that the numbers just weren't there.
You're right.
We didn't have enough men. Yeah.
We didn't have enough ships. Yeah, we didn't have enough landing craft.
And wouldn't the weather have been a factor in like the fall of? Isn't the weather, the channel weather, the same?
Yeah, it is. But what they were trying to do, the original plan that Eisenhower had mapped out back in 41, before we were even in the war, when it looks very close. The original plan had a series of steps that would have led to the cross-channel invasion, which Marshall adopts. And the first part of that would be to make England one huge supply depot, which they eventually did, actually. That was called Roundup. Then the second part was they agreed that once they had started to do that, they wanted not necessarily a full-blown invasion, but what they wanted to do was to get a lodgment on the Channel coast somewhere.
Dieppe.
Well, that's what's going to happen later. But there, and it was completely illogical. It would never have worked. And Dieppe, which is going to be tried by the Canadians at the behest of the British, with American Rangers, by the way, who do relatively well there, is an absolute disaster.
Yes.
That it happens in August of 43. Which is going to be, now the British will claim will be their model for the D-Day invasion later on by the lessons we learned. And to a certain extent that might be true, but I don't think that would have worked. Clearly we were not ready until when it happened. It, first of all, supplies wouldn't have been there yet, men weren't trained yet, the landing craft weren't even ready yet. I mean, the British had been at this battle, at the war for 2 years already, and they knew the Germans. And the Germans, one thing they were good at is defensive combat. Yes?
We saw the German burials at Normandy.
Yeah.
And indeed, there were teenage boys.
Yes.
Cleaning it up, doing the mowing and doing...
College students will be brought in from Germany now.
Right.
Yeah, very much so.
That's what we saw.
And now, I was telling Rich at dinner, they're also sending them out to Russia now to reclaim the bodies. There's a big movement afoot in Germany, by the way, to reclaim the German dead from the Eastern Front. They were buried, usually were buried in mass graves by the Russians, if at all. And so there's a major move afoot to do that. In fact, you see, if you go to Stalingrad, Volgograd, you'll see what the Germans have done there, where they've been allowed to comb the fields and bring the bodies in and create their own cemetery, as long as they create one for the Russians, which they've done. And now the Russians are doing the same thing, by the way. I've told Richard that I met when I did my Eastern campaign tours, I met Russian army units. I've run into them in some of the locations where they're digging the locations up to reclaim the bodies of their soldiers who are still in the ground and bring out the material. This officer told me, he said, look, with DNA, he's one of the few that spoke English, he said, with DNA we can now relocate families to their long lost one as to what happened to them. But it's more important for these young men, he says, he pointed to these young soldiers that looked like 17 or 18, that they understand what the sacrifice that took place here was. Yeah. So, thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.
Thank you. And I want to thank you all for coming. If we don't have your email address, is the sheet still out there?
We've got it all.
Oh, we have it all. Okay, well, thank you all for coming, and we'll send an email out for the next event.